Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. It's your girl Nungu, back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course, do not forget to subscribe. A big shout out to everyone that has subscribed to our channel and keeps on watching our videos. And a big shout out to the person that suggested this. So without wasting time, today I'm going to be reacting to how did the Prophet Muhammad and companions respond to abuse. So without wasting time, let's get into the video. Allahu
Akbar. A'udhu billahi as-sami'il 'alim minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wal 'udwani illa 'alal zalimin wal 'aqibatu lil muttaqin. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik 'ala 'abdika wa rasulika Muhammadin sallallahu 'alayhi wa sallam wa 'ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima katheera. So just like that question was asked, how many of you have not heard a YouTube clip or a lecture, or read some sort of article about how the Prophet ﷺ used to respond to insults? Very few of us, right? We've all heard different things, different clips. We've seen material from both the mainstream and from the extremists, and the Islamophobes and radicalists tend to agree on how the Prophet ﷺ responded. And we always have the narrative of the Sunnah caught in between. And subhanAllah, you know, out of all of the talks that I have this year at this convention, this is the one that I actually studied the most. Why? Because I'm sick of the rosy comments about how the Prophet ﷺ responded to insults without substantial evidence. It shakes each and every single one of us, especially if we're not intellectually equipped, when we post something about how the Prophet ﷺ used to respond with love, and someone throws a hadith in there that appears to not be so. And we don't know how to respond to that because we're not tackling these things head on. So inshallah ta'ala, I want you all to pay attention with me, because the argument of the Islamophobes, if you listen to Alan West, for example, who is by far one of the most idiotic and radical Islamophobes out there, too extremist even for the Republican Party, all right? Alan West's argument, in his own words, he said something happened to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he got to Medina. Yeah, all those narrations, all those verses of the Qur'an, everything about the Prophet ﷺ responding with love and with tolerance and with compassion, all of that was in Mecca. If some of you might remember, when Pope Benedict quoted some old, you know, crusader historiography that mentioned the Prophet ﷺ, of course they see him as the author of the Qur'an, as having been very tolerant in Mecca, but then, you know, and all those verses like La ikraha fi din, there is no compulsion in religion, which is a Madani verse, which is a verse that was revealed in Medina. Their argument was that all those verses of there is no compulsion in religion and respond with that which is better and so on and so forth were all Mekki ayahs. They were all verses that came down in Mecca before the Messenger ﷺ held a position of authority. Once the Prophet ﷺ got into a position of authority, all the verses of jihad, all the verses of attacking the disbelievers, kill them wherever you find them, so on and so forth, started to be revealed. And obviously we all cringed at that, but how many of us could intellectually answer that? How many of us could give an academic answer to that? So that's what I want to do today. Number one, something to keep in mind here. Whether it's coming from the Islamophobes or from us, viewing the seerah through the Qur'an is the very first foundation of this discussion. What I mean by that is that to the Islamophobes, the Prophet ﷺ is the author of the Qur'an. Meaning to them, he is the one that authors this divine revelation, or what's supposedly a divine revelation, in his favor as it suits him politically and economically. To us as Muslims, Aisha radiallahu anha said about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كان خلقه القرآن. His character was the Qur'an. قرآنٌ يمشي في الأرض. He was a walking Qur'an. Therefore, everything you see in the Qur'an is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. And so we have to study the seerah through the lens of the Qur'an, number one. Number two, to use the exception to override the general is something that is prohibited and is not true to our principles in Islamic scholarship. Not in usul al-fiqh, nor in usul al-deen as a whole, in the foundations of deriving principles and deriving rules and axioms in our religion. So to take one incident out of context, to justify an entire principle, an entire maxim, is in and of itself, you know, not true to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So when someone posts the incident of Ka'b ibn Ashraf, Ka'b ibn Ashraf, who is supposedly just a poet, who is authoring poetry about the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ sent Muhammad ibn Maslama radiallahu anhu and someone else to take him out. To just put that incident there without offering any context is not true to the text, even if you're a Muslim. Why? Because Ka'b ibn Ashraf was not a poet. Ka'b ibn Ashraf was a warmonger. Ka'b ibn Ashraf was inciting people, to actually attack Muslim women. And in some narrations of Al-Razi and others, other scholars of Sirah, he actually did attack people. So Ka'b ibn Ashraf is a warmonger. So you can't use incidents that are the exception to justify an entire principle and to claim this to be the behavior of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam expected out of us. So let's go through a timeline. Number one, we look at the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca. And in Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was powerless. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam belonged to an oppressed group of people. And we know this very well, that when a group of people are oppressed, they will often resort to unethical tactics to get the ruling class to listen to them. It works, right? That's why you have terrorist groups. That's the way to get a government, that's the way that these terrorist groups try to get a government to listen to them. They will attack a civilian population and then, now you have to listen to us because we're not able to fight on your terms. That's what they will do. Did the Prophet ﷺ resort to violence? Did he resort to terrorism even as violence was executed against him systematically, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even as he was economically oppressed, even as the Prophet ﷺ lost his family members, even as he was forced to witness the worst forms of torture being carried out on his community, not for a few months, but supposedly in a time where there was no end in sight. They didn't know when they were in Mecca, being boycotted and being killed and being stoned and being treated the way they were, that Medina was after this. They were told to take it as it is and to be patient with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you resort unethically to people, when you respond to injustice with injustice, you are not following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You're doing the exact opposite of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. You've become no better than your enemy. You've become no better than your oppressor. You no longer have a right to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help if you respond to violent oppressors with violence and terrorism. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do in Mecca? What was his approach? Number one, the emotional taunting, the insults that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to endure that upset his companions more than they upset him. When they even changed the name of the Prophet ﷺ and they started to say, Mudhammam. Muhammad means he who is highly praised. And they started to say, Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, the father of Khalid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he fabricated this lie, or he took the name of the Prophet ﷺ and changed it to Mudhammam. He said, he's not the one who's highly praised, he is the one who is subdued and humiliated. And the companions couldn't bear that. Hearing that the Prophet ﷺ's name was, he was being called Mudhammam instead of Muhammad. Who was the one that came to them? The Prophet ﷺ didn't come to them and say, if that upsets you, why don't you do something about it? The Prophet ﷺ didn't come to them and say, do you see these people, what they're doing to my name? Because he knows the effect of that speech. The Messenger ﷺ knows that would incite them. Instead, the Prophet ﷺ comes to him with his glowing smile. And he says to them, أَلَا تَعْجَبُونَ كَيْفَ يَصْرِفُ اللَّهُ عَنِّي شَتَمَ قُرَيْشٍ وَلَعْنَهُمْ. Aren't you amazed by how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has removed the insults of Quraysh from me and their cursing? He said, كَيْفَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهُ. How is that, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَشْتِمُونَ مُذَمَّمًا. They curse a man named Mudhammam. And they insult a man named Mudhammam. And I'm Muhammad, I'm not Mudhammam. Subhanallah, Allah changed them and redirected them. That should be our approach. When we see those, this circus, this traveling circus of Pamela Geller going city to city, being ignored even by the mainstream, drawing pictures of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're not drawing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're drawing the picture of a man with a beard. That's not Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's not who he was. Those aren't his shama'il. If they tried to capture his beauty, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his true shama'il, they would not be able to do so. Let him be.
Don't feed the trolls. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, let them be. They're cursing mudhammam. They're not cursing me. They're not worth our time. They're not worth a response when they're willing to go to those tactics. So the emotional taunting that the Prophet ﷺ had to go through. Also the fact that the Prophet ﷺ still found it in his heart to make dua for the very same people that were insulting him. You know, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send us to this world to curse people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send us to this world to condemn people to hell. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam still had the heart to make dua for the Pharaoh of this ummah, the Fir'aun of this ummah in Abu Jahl. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make dua, Allahumma izzal Islam, oh Allah, give victory to Islam, give help to Islam, bi ahad al umarain, with one of the two Umars, and one narration, bi ahab al umarain ilayk, with the more beloved of the two Umars to you, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu and Amir ibn Hisham, Abu Jahl. Two oppressors, the Prophet ﷺ still saw good in them. If the Prophet ﷺ would have raised his hand and said, oh Allah, destroy the two Umars, they would have been gone. They would have been gone. But the Messenger ﷺ, he still sees something in them, and his heart is still big enough to where he can accept the same people that have oppressed him for years, that have tried to crush his message, that have killed his family members. He can accept them. He still wishes good for them. With all the evil, not that they wish for him, but that they've inflicted on him, the Prophet ﷺ still wishes good for them. He still wishes good for the people of Ta'if that stoned him and gave him the worst day of his life. He still makes dua for them. He doesn't lose hope in them. And that shows you that the Prophet ﷺ understands where the help truly comes from. Where it really comes from. I don't need to be like them. And I'll give you the first ayah that you've heard multiple times in this discussion and where it was revealed. اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Respond to that which is evil with that which is better. And you would find that the people who were your most severe enemies will become your protecting friends, meaning not only will they warm up to you, they will join you and they will become your friends, they will become your allies, they will protect you. You know when that ayah was revealed? It was revealed after the Islam of Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, before the Islam of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Meaning what? Hamza, when Hamza became Muslim, it was a big boost for the Muslims because this was the first powerful man that became Muslim. And the Muslims had some hope. And Allah is telling the Prophet ﷺ and the believers that this isn't the first one. Continue to respond with dignity. Continue to give an ethical, compassionate response and you will find more Hamzas. Shortly after that, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu becomes Muslim, who is even more powerful than Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Quran. Then we move on to Medina. The Prophet ﷺ now is in a position of authority. He can now do whatever he wants. He's no longer a fugitive. He's no longer boycotted. He's no longer marked for death sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now he has authority. What does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do with that authority? Number one, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي. There is no compulsion in religion was revealed in Medina, contrary to what was argued by Pope Benedict. Number two, the Prophet ﷺ entered Medina with such grace that his enemies, when they tried to break him, they couldn't. Rasulullah ﷺ was tested severely in Medina by those that wanted to make him out to not be a prophet. One of them, a man by the name of Zayd ibn Sa'na. Zayd ibn Sa'na was one of the two chief rabbis of Medina. The Prophet ﷺ said that if 10 rabbis in Medina became Muslim, all of the Jews in Medina would become Muslim. Three of them became Muslim. One of them is Zayd ibn Sa'na. Zayd ibn Sa'na tested the Prophet ﷺ. How did he test him? He came to him as a rabbi. And he lended the Prophet ﷺ some money, and the Prophet ﷺ lended him some money. They did business dealings together. And in one of those times that the Prophet ﷺ had some money from him, he came to the Prophet ﷺ a week before the loan was due. And he started to yell at the Prophet ﷺ in front of the companions and insult the Messenger ﷺ in front of the companions. Now the Prophet ﷺ is in Medina. He's in charge here. He could say, are you guys going to let this happen? You going to take care of this or what? And guess what? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, He said, Ya Rasulullah, I got this. Let me at him. And when Zayd ibn Sa'na saw Umar radiallahu anhu saying, I've got this guy, I'll take care of him, the Prophet ﷺ said, that's not what I wanted from you, O Umar. He said, instead, you take him and you give him back the 20 pounds of dates that he is owed and give him an extra 20 for the way that you treated him. Subhanallah, the way he treated the Prophet ﷺ was irrelevant to him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You go and you treat him better. Umar radiallahu anhu walked with Zayd ibn Sa'na, and Zayd said, do you know who I am, O Umar? Umar said, no.
I have to make this video in two parts because it's quite long, and I did react to the way Muhammad responded to stuff, and that still was me. There's a few people that actually can do such a thing. I learned this from my sister, that when someone insults you, just say thank you, and they'll feel ashamed if they have a conscience. Otherwise, respond with kindness, and people just don't give people your time. Don't give them that satisfaction that they're affecting. You never do that. Let me get to the second part of this video.